going to be a treat tonight. We have one of our regulars, Dr. Todd Miles, is going to be with us. He's come down from Western Seminary in Portland. And he's going to be speaking to us tonight on the topic of whether or not faith is rational. And this is one that is very pertinent to this university here because we have two things happening at the same time. There is this academic thrust. So there are all kinds of students in different disciplines, and they are keen to know, and they are keen to process what they know and to connect the things that they know. And this is also a place where there's quite a bit of faith. We have many students who are strong believers and who are seeking to integrate what they believe with the things that academia says that they know. So I'm looking forward to this talk very much. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Todd Miles.
It's always good to be back on campus here at Oregon State. I was driving in with my daughter, Natalie. I was telling her, this is my favorite town in the entire world. If there's any place that I would like to live, it would be Corvallis. You just need to put a seminary here in town. It's like, come. It is very good to be back. It feels like sacred ground to me. So. I wanted to talk with you tonight about, is faith rational? And the reason for that should be very apparent. The recent presidential election and subsequent fallout from it has thrown into sharp relief the importance of truth claims and their justification. We now live in a world where alternative facts and fake news are part of everyone's vocabulary. And they probably were not part of everyone's vocabulary 6 months ago or 9 months ago. We don't know where to turn for truth. And those entities historically entrusted with keeping us informed, like the press, the media, have never had so little credibility. How do we discern what is true? In the past, epistemic warrant or the justification of my beliefs. How do I know what I know, and is it credible to say that I know these things? That kind of epistemic warrant might not have been a felt need for people, but it surely is now. So I'm going to talk on the subject of, is faith rational? But in the interest of full disclosure, I want you to know exactly where I'm coming from. First and foremost, I am a Christian. That means that I am a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, someone who identifies and understands himself to be a sinner in need of reconciliation with the holy God. I understand that in mercy, God sent his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, to atone for my sin. I understand that in space-time history, Jesus was born, lived, and then was crucified on a Roman cross, but then was raised from the dead in space-time history and then ascended to God the Father. I also understand and believe that Jesus will return to judge the earth in righteousness and consummate his kingdom, resulting in a new heavens and a new earth. I understand the Bible to be the supernaturally inspired word of God. And in obedience to Jesus Christ, I orient my life around the local church. That is, I am a Christian in the historically recognizable sense of the word. That's where I'm coming to you from. I am not but also a graduate of Oregon State University with 2 degrees in engineering. I spent 10 years working as a research engineer at a United States National Laboratory, and since then I've been heavily involved in graduate theological education. I tell you all of this so that you might know that I care deeply about faith and reason, and I have great respect for science. As we address this question, is faith rational, we need to understand that it's actually a very modern question. Few seriously ask that question in the pre-modern world. And it's not that the question was unimportant in that pre-modern world, it's just that the question did not rise to the consciousness of most pre-modern thinkers. We need to understand that the world presents plausibility structures for belief and unbelief. It always has. In the pre-modern world, because of the plausibility structures, it was largely impossible not to believe in God. In the modern world, it was possible not to believe. In the postmodern world, some suggest that it's impossible to believe. But is that really the case? I want to do two things tonight. First, I want to defend the idea that faith is rational. Christians often call this negative apologetics, that is, the rebuffing of attacks by skeptics, the attempt perhaps to persuade the skeptic that the Christian is within his or her epistemic rights for having faith in God. Short form, we're not crazy. And finally, I want to suggest that faith in the God revealed in Jesus Christ and then testified to in the Bible is more than simply rational. But it might rise to the level of obligation or epistemic duty. Christians often call this positive apologetics, that is, pointing out that unbelievers, those without this faith, have an uncomfortable fit in their belief structures that can be reconciled through faith in God. So, is faith rational? Well, in order to make sense of that question, we need to define our terms. So, especially faith and reason. I did what everybody does when you want to define terms. I went to dictionary.com. According to Merriam, I actually went to Merriam-Webster online. Faith is, first, an allegiance to duty or a person. Second definition, firm belief in something for which there is not proof. And we have here, I believe, an interesting contrast captured in these two definitions. Strikes me that most people who have a religious faith, if you're someone who understands himself or herself to be a theist, you would be very comfortable with that first definition, an allegiance to duty or a person. That person, in particular, in this case, would be God. To the faithless, to those who don't understand themselves to be religious, faith probably seems more like the latter, belief in something for which there is not proof. And therein lies the crux of this issue. Now, I want you to know I would happily join the non-theist who argues that faith is irrational if it means belief in something for which there is no evidence or proof. But of course, that's not what the theist understands faith to be. According to the Christian scriptures, faith is being sure of what we hope for, being certain of what we do not see. Christians don't understand faith to be hope in spite of overwhelming evidence to the contrary. So before we can judge the rationality of faith, we have to ask, faith in what? Or faith that what? Because it is the object of faith that is largely determinative of the rationality of the said belief. And I am not here to defend an abstract notion of faith. And I am equally certain that you did not come here to hear me do so. Most came tonight, I expect, understanding that a discussion on the question, is faith rational, would really be about the question, is faith in God rational? But even that question is not particular enough, because then it would depend upon the nature of the God in question. There are many different conceptions of God believed by many people around the world, and not all of them are equal in terms of likelihood or attractiveness. So, to lay all my cards on the table, I will defend the thesis that faith in the triune God, the God revealed in Jesus Christ, is completely rational. Even though most of what I say tonight in the defense of the rationality of faith will be applicable to the many different conceptions of God and the different religions of our pluralistic world, I have no interest, quite frankly, in defending a notion of bare theism that is equally valid for the Buddhist or the Muslim or the Christian. So, with that out of the way, before we can delve too far into the rationality of a theist's faith, we have to continue to define our terms. So next up, what is it to be rational? What is that? And here, dictionary.com fails us, quite frankly. To be rational is to be agreeable to reason, exercising sound judgment or good sense, being in or characterized by full possession of one's reason, sane or lucid. So essentially, we're told that rationality is the exercise of reason, which is not very helpful at all. So where do we go? Well, in order to understand what something means, we go to context. Context is always the best determiner of meaning, and it is to that which we must turn. So tonight, we're thinking about rationality with regard to faith and knowledge. Knowledge is often defined as justified true belief. So, if I claim to know something, I have to believe it, and it has to be true. I can't really have knowledge of something that is false. No matter how loud or impassioned my truth claim might be, volume is really not a good argument. Okay? And sincerity, even though that's very attractive, is not a determiner of knowledge either. People can be sincerely wrong. They might be more pleasant to be around than someone who is obnoxious and wrong, but they're still sincerely wrong. Because unless what I claim about reality actually obtains, I really don't know something. For example, a University of Oregon student can claim that the Ducks won the football Civil War this last year, but that makes them delusional, not correct. I could have just said that makes them a Duck fan, and that would have been fine. Yeah. That's why I love coming to Oregon State, to say things like that. Actually, I would say that no matter where I was. Likewise, it would be nonsense for another Oregon student to claim that he knows that Oregon won the Civil War, but he does not really believe that they did. So in order to have knowledge, one must believe that the truth claim, and it must also be true. But belief and truth are not alone sufficient for knowledge. One cannot know something unless that true belief is also justified. And as I'm going to strive to make clear, how a truth claim is justified will depend upon the nature of the claim being made. For now, to return to our Civil War example, a discouraged Duck fan before the game was played might have predicted that the Ducks would lose to the Beavers. And he might have, in his despair, passionately believed that that would be the case. But he could not claim, prior to the game being played, to have actual knowledge of the Beavers beating the Ducks until the beatdown actually took place. In that case, and I'm so glad they're on the show. In that case, he might possess true belief, but it's not a justified true belief. It's not knowledge. And it's the issue of justification that takes us to the heart of the matter of whether or not faith is rational. To be rational is often a gloss for, I have evidence for believing. More properly, to be rational is to have epistemic justification, epistemology, the study of how we know what we know. To have epistemic justification or warrant for my belief, whatever that belief might be. And in our modern world, that evidence is typically taken to be scientific, and the stakes are very, very high. W.K. Clifford, the 19th century mathematician and philosopher, famously taught that the strength of one's belief ought always to be proportional to the strength of the evidence for that belief. That is, we are always obliged or obligated to have sufficient evidence for every one of our beliefs. Otherwise, it's not a belief worth having. And in so doing, Clifford thrust belief in the modern world into the arena of ethics. We are morally obligated to believe those things for which we have sufficient evidence, and we are morally obligated to disbelieve those things for which we do not have sufficient evidence. So, if this is the case, then to be rational is not necessarily to be correct. To be rational is to think rightly in the pursuit of coming to true knowledge. To quote philosopher Alvin Plantinga, to be rational is to do the right thing with respect to one's believings. It is to violate no epistemic duties. And to this, let me say that I agree with Plantinga, but I can only go so far with Clifford. Clifford was right, I think, to thrust belief and knowledge into the arena of ethics. What we think and what we believe matters. It's probably never been apparent that it matters so much as right now. But I question Clifford's commitment to evidence, or at least the kind of evidence that he was calling for, because I don't think that he, or anyone for that matter, could or can live consistently or rightly by that standard. So how might I defend the rationality of faith? Some would have us believe that the Christian has abandoned rationality and, with great sacrifice of intellect, chosen to live by faith. That is, to be a Christian is the intellectual equivalent of one who follows the Queen of Hearts' advice in Through the Looking Glass, where she instructs Alice to believe six impossible things before breakfast. That's the kind of intellectual suicide that Christians have to commit in order to be Christian. And so goes the argument. Belief in God is unjustified because it does not meet the evidentiary burden, with evidence in our day and age typically defined by science. I mean, who is it that questions the rationality of faith more than a naturalist would? Examples of this are legion, but to name a few, Richard Dawkins in The God Delusion, Sam Harris in Letters to a Christian Nation, and then more recently, just in the last couple days, New Hampshire State Representative Brandon Finney, who in responding to a report that his state was one of the least religious in America, with great delight, opined, in an age of information, scientific progress, and exploration, and the understanding of the workings of our world, it is difficult, and to be frank, rather foolish, to hold on to archaic beliefs that deny reality. Well, this kind of thinking has a long history in the modern world, where it was thought, and then taught, that knowledge was built upon the foundation of what were called basic beliefs. Basic beliefs were those propositions that were self-evident or axiomatic, like all bachelors are unmarried men, just a way of defining things, setting your terms. Or, second, they were incorrigible, that is, a statement of your own mind that cannot be disproven, like, I like apples. Now, it could be that apples are rather nasty, but no one could deny that I like them. That is a true statement. It's impossible to prove me wrong, unless somehow you could get into my mind and say Todd was actually lying when he said that he does not like apples. The best example of an incorrigible belief would be Descartes' cogito. I think, therefore I am. He knew that he existed because he was thinking. And who could deny that he was thinking? Some people might deny that he was thinking coherently, but no one could deny that he was thinking, right? And he existed. He knew he existed because he was thinking. And then the third is those things that are evident to the senses, like, I see people in this room. I trust my senses. I see all of you out there. I'm seeing live people. I'm not seeing dead people, at least at this point of the lecture. So I won't offer any warnings about how this is going to go, but I think you'll survive. Non-basic beliefs, that is, everything else that we believe, are accepted on the basis or the foundation of basic beliefs. So to illustrate, a scientific experiment makes sense because it's based upon the foundation of basic beliefs. A scientific experiment is not properly basic, but all that goes into a scientific experiment is grounded on properly basic beliefs. And so you build your knowledge edifice. For someone like Descartes, he thought, I'm going to doubt everything until I get down to something that's not doubtable anymore, and then I'm going to rebuild the knowledge edifice. And so he doubted everything until he stumbled upon the idea that, well, I must exist because I know that I'm doubting. And so that was his kind of his foundation. And then he began to build his knowledge edifice on that foundation of that basic belief. And the scientific method found a happy home in this kind of foundationalism. Belief in God, so it is argued by some, cannot be a basic belief because it's not self-evident, it's not incorrigible or evident to the senses. I can say, I think God exists, and no one can argue with me on that because I do think that God exists. But to say God does exist, well, that's neither self-evident to the senses, it's not axiomatic, and it's not incorrigible. And it certainly is not a non-basic belief because it doesn't necessarily follow or logically follow from any of the basic beliefs. Therefore, faith must be irrational. But is this true? Is this true? Is it unreasonable or irrational to accept theistic belief in the absence of scientific reasons or evidence? So, how do we determine truth claims? How do we actually do that? We need to recognize that tests for truth are determined by the nature of the truth claim itself. It is perfectly reasonable to perform a scientific test for the claim that the acceleration due to gravity is 9.8 meters per second squared. My master's advisor is sitting here. I have not forgotten that. But what about the truth claim that I ate breakfast yesterday morning? Where's the scientific test for that? I suppose that my stomach could be pumped for evidence, but I'm not sure how far that will get you, nor is it a particularly pleasant way to determine the rationality of my statement. Is it really irrational of me to believe that I ate breakfast yesterday morning in the absence of such evidence? How do you prove it? Am I irrational just for trusting my memory? More to the point, is it irrational for you to believe that I ate breakfast yesterday on the basis of my testimony when neither of us have scientific evidence for the fact that I ate breakfast yesterday? There are a host of issues like this. How does one prove the existence of other minds? I can see it's evidence, the senses, that you have bodies, but how do I know that you have a mind? How do I prove that? How does one prove that there is an actual past, rather than the world coming into existence with fake memories just moments ago? How do you do that? Or what about this? What about the claim, my wife loves me? I believe this, not on the basis of Petri dish analysis, subatomic particle formations, a blood test, or any other such exam devised by people wearing white lab coats. Remember, I have great respect for people wearing white lab coats, just not on the issue of whether my wife loves me or not. I believe she loves me based on a promise made by her to me in the context of our marriage covenant. Am I irrational for believing my wife loves me in the absence of such scientific evidence and knowing that it fails the tests of basic beliefs? This is important because this is the kind of faith that's more akin to biblical faith. Biblical faith in God, because faith in God is trusting that God is who he says he is, and he will do what he has promised to do. So obviously, I think there's plenty of evidence that my wife loves me. But honestly, it's probably not the kind of evidence that could not be questioned. I suppose if there was some strange person out there who was going to be skeptical of that truth claim, Todd's wife loves him, that person could come up with plausible scenarios by which all the things that I find to be evidence of my wife's love for me are actually evidence of something more self-interested on her part that have really nothing to do with me. But I would propose that the skeptic's belief is more irrational than mine. It's a more rational truth claim to say Todd's wife loves him than to say Todd's wife actually doesn't love him. When I trip over toys on my living room floor, I believe that my children left them there. I cannot prove it. I don't have security cameras in my living room just yet. And I do not immediately work through a logical syllogism about my sense experience and my children's proclivity to leave things on the floor. The belief just instantly forms in the absence of scientific verification. Is that belief irrational? When I hop on an airplane or climb in an elevator, I have no scientific evidence immediately available to me that the contraption is going to get me safely to my desired destination. And I have to confess, I never read the licensing and inspection documents, no matter how bored I am on an elevator. I know that they usually say something like Otis, but after that, that's about as far as I go. I take it as a matter of trust, and that trust rarely is sorted out in some kind of logical syllogism where I reflect on the past and the credibility of the past positive elevator experiences that I have. I simply believe the elevator will deliver me to the desired floor. Is that faith irrational? I think we need to be very careful with the claim that beliefs are irrational and then establish some criteria by which that belief fails the test of rationality, and that's often how it happens. How about this? Is a child irrational for believing in Santa Claus when her parents have told her that Santa is the person who fills the stockings on Christmas Eve? It's a false belief. I hope I'm not breaking this to anybody. It's a false belief, but is it irrational? Now, that's not to say that all beliefs are rational. The parents of the Santa believer would be irrational for believing in Santa if they were the ones actually filling the stockings. I suppose it's possible grandparents could be sneaking into the house and perpetuating the myth, but normally we would say that the child, it's rational for her to believe in Santa Claus because she's accepting that fact on solid testimony and evidence such as it exists, but the parents are probably lying, and if they continue to do so, to that would be irrational. Here is where evidence can intrude and raise questions pertaining to rationality. Can I justify all my beliefs, at least according to the demands of modern science? Probably not. Is a child irrational for believing that he sees a bird out his window, even if he cannot explain philosophically why he trusts his own senses? I think so. John Frames, the philosopher, says, many of our beliefs are held in this sort of way. We believe them. We have a right to believe them, but we can't articulate our reasons for believing them. George Mavrodis, more to the point, another philosopher, says that many people cannot articulate reasons, but that does not mean that they don't have them. Much the same way, I agree with the philosopher and reformed epistemologist Alvin Plantinga, who has made the convincing case that belief in God is properly basic, even though it does not meet the tests of classic foundationalism. I am within my epistemic rights for believing that God exists. Plantinga also suggests that belief in God is properly basic and the believer is within his or her epistemic rights in the complete absence of reason and evidence. Now I'm a little more hesitant to go that far. The Christian scriptures, though, back up this idea that belief in God is basic. Among other arguments presented in the Bible are what the Protestant reformers called sensus divinitatis, a sense of the divine. There's the work of the law that is written on our hearts, the conscience, things like that. I'm exceedingly leery of arguments against theistic belief because there is not scientific evidence for that belief. Most who would make the claim are committed to philosophical naturalism. They will allow evidence as being scientific only if it obeys the dictates of philosophical naturalism. But what's actually going on here? The theist is asked to prove the existence of a supernatural God within a naturalistic framework. Any explanation appealing to supernaturalism that might be presented in defense of the supernatural God is ruled out of bounds by the naturalist because it does not meet naturalistic criteria. Logically speaking, we call that begging the question. It's a fallacy. Where I grew up, we call it cooking the books. You can't persuade the naturalist that a supernatural God exists while submitting to the prerequisites of the naturalist. And I think it's a fool's errand for any theist to attempt to do so. But this does not mean that we're stuck with our beliefs. I take it that despite naturalism's protestations, the theist is within his or her epistemic rights to believe in God. He or she is rational for having faith, but that doesn't mean that all faith is by definition rational. Nor does it mean that faith cannot be challenged or even defeated. We are not stuck with our beliefs. Believing something, in spite of incontrovertible or overwhelming evidence, I believe is irrational. Now, I would caution that incontrovertible is a difficult standard to achieve, particularly in this question, faith. But that does not mean that evidence cannot question or even defeat arguments for faith. If I'm presented with evidence or reasons that run contrary to my beliefs, I should change them. I ought to. Recall what I said about the ethics of belief. I think we are obligated to believe those things for which we have sufficient evidence. I don't use the word obligated lightly. There's an oughtness that is integral to thinking and knowing. I ought to believe those things that are true and for which I have sufficient evidence. I ought not believe those things that are false and for which I do not have sufficient reason or evidence. I understand this to be the case because of what my Christian tradition tells me about the God who created the world, who created me, who created me to know something about the world. That teaching has also been consistent with my experience and the dictates of reason. Some of that evidence might not even meet the verification demands of modern science. For example, if my wife tells me that she was the one who left the kids' toys on the living room floor, I might look at her strangely for a moment. I might think she's just covering for her children. But if she persists in the confession, eventually my belief that my children left the toys on the floor will give way to begrudging acceptance that it was my wife who was playing with Legos, not my children, and it was she, not them, who left them on the living room floor. It sounds implausible, but I could be convinced of that if she persisted. Many, both theists and non-theists, suggest that faith is irrational, citing Kierkegaard's leap of faith. By this, many wrongly understand Kierkegaard to suggest that a leap of faith is a decision to believe something in spite of the evidence. I say that this is a wrong understanding of Kierkegaard because his philosophy is a bit more robust than that. His leap of faith is the transition from the ethical conviction to the religious conviction. Kierkegaard was suspicious of the power of reason to determine choices, and for good reason. There are many things that might influence a belief in addition to reason. Things such as habits, who your parents are, environment, feelings, what you even ate for breakfast, or what I ate for breakfast yesterday, even. But that does not mean that I cannot have reasons for what I believe. Most importantly, Kierkegaard's work should not suggest that there is no evidence for those who believe in God, that there is no evidence for God's existence, or that the gospel of Jesus Christ is insufficient. For my part, I want to be self-aware of my beliefs. As a Christian, I find this to be mandatory. This doesn't mean that I spend all my time questioning my beliefs, some sort of like theological, philosophical navel-gazing. But it does mean that I do not fear such questioning and will do so when called upon. Jesus promised that it is the truth that will set us free, not false but sincere belief. The Apostle Peter instructed the Christian to be able to give a reason for the hope that is within him or her. That means that I must be willing to take on questions and doubters and think through their objections to my faith. All of this is what the Apostle Paul had in mind when he instructed Christians to take every thought captive in obedience to Christ. That is, to think rightly about everything. Christians ought never to be afraid of the truth. The unexamined life has no place in Christianity. An unexamined belief, I understand to be sub-Christian. Why might the unbeliever be obligated to believe? I don't want us to leave tonight feeling that I gave permission for folk to believe whatever they want. Remember that what we believe and know has an overriding ethical component to it. This is vital to understanding our postmodern context where truth is whatever you or the community makes it. I'm obligated to believe right and true claims, not just claims that work in a certain setting. It's my moral duty, and it's also yours. I think there are compelling arguments for Christianity. I believe there is sufficient evidence to embrace the truth claims of Christianity, even if they must be accepted by faith with something less than 100% scientific certainty. But that's okay. We were not created to work that way, with 100% scientific certainty behind everything that we believe. And no one actually functions that way. Christians have, for millennia, been answering skeptics and developing arguments for the existence of God and the truths of Christianity. As is common to argumentation, some arguments are more persuasive than others, and there is a subjective element to what is persuasive. For example, I find the ontological argument for the existence of God put forward by Anselm, God is that being than which none greater can be conceived. A God that exists is greater than a God who does not exist, therefore God exists. I find that, that's called the ontological argument for the existence of God, I find that to be logically pristine and perfect, but not persuasive at all. It just sounds fishy. It sounds like I've argued God into existence semantically, and who wants to worship a God that I have to argue into existence? Arguments for God's existence based on causality, cosmological arguments, such as that you cannot have an infinite regress of contingent causes. There must be a necessary cause to kickstart the whole thing at some point. I find those to be more persuasive than the ontological argument. But those to me, I keep saying to me because it's subjective, right? To me, those are not as compelling as the teleological arguments. That the universe looks intelligently designed and is best understood to be designed by something superior to that creation. I think that's more compelling. For me, though, the most persuasive arguments are two, the transcendental argument and what I'll call the argument from story. The transcendental argument, in short form, is to argue for God's existence based on the impossibility of the contrary. One cannot form an argument using things like laws of logic against the existence of God without assuming that he exists. All such arguments are ultimately self-refuting, and too much Christian capital has to be borrowed to argue against Christian truth. The argument from story looks at the biblical storyline and asks asks the existential question of whether its explanation of where we are and who you are is compelling. Does the world make more sense according to the Bible's storyline or according to what other worldviews tell you? I understand the redemptive storyline of the Bible, creation, fall, redemption, consummation, to have the most explanatory power when it comes to the problem of evil, human suffering, why is there good in the world, why things are as they are, human dignity, why we hope for something better, things of that sort. In short, to me, the world makes sense in light of the Christian worldview, and it makes more sense than any alternative worldview that I've encountered. The Bible even has a compelling explanation for why things are not as they ought to be, and why some deny the existence of God, despite what I understand, and the scriptures understand to be, compelling evidence. So, I'd like to close this with an invitation to both Christians and non-Christians alike, to check out your faith. Or, if it's not your faith, check out the faith of Christianity. I'm not asking you to sacrifice your intellect or your critical thinking skills to make some sort of crazy leap of faith. I understand that God created the intellect. He created reason, laws of logic. He wants you to employ all of those. I also understand that God is not afraid of your questions, even your skepticism. He wants you to ask hard questions. His shoulders are big enough. He can take it. Any God too small to answer such questions is not worth your devotion or your worship. The Bible is full of invitations to seek the Lord. They're embodied best in the injunction, taste and see that the Lord is good. Now that's an invitation to scientific inquiry if I've ever heard one. If I might be so bold, I would go further. If you're going to look into the truth claims of religious faiths, I would recommend you start with Christianity. Here's why. First, this is a little more gratifying. You're not going to find a better deal out there, quite frankly. For Christianity, the offer is salvation by grace through faith. According to Christian worldview, the offer of salvation is paid for by God Himself. All you have to do is accept it. Second, the Christian faith, and this is why I would start with Christianity, if you're going to be looking at truth claims. The Christian faith is the only religion, as far as I can tell, that comes with its own criteria for falsification. As a scientist, that appeals to me. That should be a scientist's dream. Christianity hinges on the claim that in time and space, Jesus Christ died on a Roman cross and then rose from the dead. He literally got up from the dead and was so confident about it, he made room reservations ahead of that fact. If he did not do so, if Jesus still lies a moldering in the grave, then by Christianity's own admission, it is a bunch of nonsense. If you can disprove the resurrection, then you would be a fool to embrace the Christian faith, and that's what is written into the Christian scriptures. If Jesus didn't get up from the dead, you can dismiss Christianity and move on to the next thing on the list. But if he did get up from the dead, and I think there's pretty compelling evidence that he did, based upon eyewitness testimony, the changed lives of those who saw him, the enduring presence and testimony of the church, all of these are cumulative. If he did get up from the dead, then you might want to listen to some of the other claims that he made. I think he's got some credibility now. These claims, including such politically incorrect things like being the Son of God and being the only way to be reconciled to God, are also capable of withstanding careful scrutiny. Is there a DNA test? No. Did Jesus leave fingerprints? I'm not sure. I just don't know that we have anything that we can match it to. Is it that kind of experience? Is it that kind of evidence? No. But there's a lot of testimony evidence. There's a lot of historical evidence. If you conclude that he did not make those claims that I just articulated, then there's no real reason to follow him. But if he did, you might want to listen. So, is faith rational? Well, maybe, maybe not. Faith in what? That's the question. Is faith in Christ rational? My testimony is yes. And I'm done. And so we can... as long as you want. be about anything. I do not know who will win the Civil War next year, but I hope it is the Beavers.
Hi.
Hello.
My name's Lydia. And I had a question pertaining to the three reasons you gave at the end for looking into Christianity.
Yeah.
So the first reason you gave is that it's a great offer.
Yeah.
To those who find.
Yes.
Find Christ. But I think that one of the hardest questions to answer that I've found is, what about people that don't find him? Then it seems like the worst offer.
Yeah.
As you can see going yeah. about. And you mentioned that the Bible offers a lot of reason for why there's pain and suffering.
Yes.
And I think one of the hardest questions is hell. You know,
yeah.
how could a loving God have yeah. something like that for the people that don't find him? It seems
yeah.
like the worst option.
Yes.
So I guess kind of if you could expound on those reasons in the
sure.
Bible.
Yeah,
I
think I only gave two. If I remember right, there was this brilliant debate about 2 years ago here in the Socratic Club about hell and the love of God, where all of those questions were answered just perfectly. I'm totally joking because I was the one who did it. Let's think about this for just a moment. There were a couple of questions there. Lydia, right? There were a couple of questions there. One was, I think, encapsulating the idea of what about those who've never heard, or maybe those who seek and come and just through perhaps even no fault of their own, they don't come to the same conclusion. Well, the follow-up to that was, how do you reconcile this great offer of salvation with hell? I think that those answers are interrelated, so I'll talk for a brief moment and hopefully addressing both of them. This biblical storyline that I'm talking about here, and when I say story, I don't mean like false or made up or mythological or anything. I just mean that it comes with a beginning and a plot twist and resolution and such. And so what we find in the beginning, the origin, is that God created everything. He created mankind. He created them perfect. He created them innocent. And there was no sin, there was no rebellion until humanity chose to do that. And so right off the bat, we need to realize that according to the scriptures, we're not neutral. We're not neutral. As a matter of fact, the scriptures portray humanity far from being neutral, that they're actually antagonistic toward God, they're rebelling against God. And God is also seen to be holy, and perfect. He is the one who maintains the fabric of the cosmos. He is the righteous judge. And we also find there that God cannot just forgive. That forgiveness is always costly. It always costs something. And I think we understand that from our own experience. But God certainly can, because he's holy and righteous. And so what God does for us in this offer of salvation that I was trumpeting a moment ago is that God reconciles us to himself by taking upon himself the penalty, if you will, that which it takes to right the scales of justice. So the people, all people, are, at least from the Bible's perspective, are not really neutral. They've actually rebelled against God. And so the idea that there's an innocent person out there who's desperately seeking God, but it just is going to come up short, according to the Bible's logic, that person just doesn't exist. Even the so-called seeker has a heart that is antagonistic towards God. And this is why Christians talk of the gospel being such good news. There's no good news if there's not bad news. The bad news is that all of humanity, each of us, every man and woman, we have a serious problem. And the problem is that God has a problem with us. And I know that's difficult for people to understand, because we like to think, reasonably high about ourselves. You know, we know we're not Mother Teresa, but we're definitely not Adolf Hitler. And God probably has a standard of justice. And that makes sense to most people. He's got a standard of justice. And that standard is probably somewhere below my behavior, right? So I'm probably good enough. But the scriptures don't portray that at all. The scriptures say, you have a problem. And the problem is that God has a problem with us, so we have rebelled against him. And so, anyway, that was a long answer to this sort of thing. But that's kind of the biblical storyline that we're confronted with. And I think that actually makes sense. It doesn't mean that everybody's as evil as they can possibly be. I don't think anybody's as evil as they can possibly be. But the Bible explains why that is too. We were created in the image of God. And that image was not destroyed or eliminated at the fall. But we were terribly distorted. So that's how I walk through that. Anybody else?
Did you make that comparison in order to say something along the lines of, in Christianity, you don't have to earn that forgiveness?
Oh, when I said that if I were searching, I would start with Christianity?
Yeah,
I think it's a pretty good deal. Yeah, you don't have to earn that salvation. It has been, you know, the good news is the offer of salvation to all those who will trust in Christ, who will admit that what God says about us in scriptures is right and true, and will accept that offering on our behalf. God, you know, God reconciling the world to himself through his Son. It's a pretty good deal. There's not a better one out there.
So, Dr. Miles, I present this question for you with highest regard for your intellectual ability, but back to the health thing.
Yeah.
Why don't just annihilate us?
Yeah. Okay. Well, I think the answer to that would be because God, for whatever reason, has chosen to allow us to matter. That what we actually do matters here. I'm morally significant. And I find that to be comforting, even though if misused, it can be devastating. So if I just get snuffed out for having done something, well, I'm not sure that actually balances scales. I think it says to God, what you do or what you did doesn't really matter, so I'm just going to eliminate you. It also tells to the victims of the sins perpetrated that I just took care of it, and they don't exist anymore. And I think that God has granted us the dignity of being morally significant beings, that what we actually do here matters. Everything that we do actually matters. That's comforting, but if misused, and unfortunately we've all misused that significance, then the penalty can be devastating. So scripture is very clear. God takes no delight in the destruction of the wicked. I trust that's the case. I don't think God gets his jollies by torturing people. I don't think that's the case. I don't know what the nature of hell is other than it's unpleasant. You don't want to go there. That's how it is. It's also fair to say that the church is, I wouldn't say completely, you know, divided on this part, but there are Christians who believe otherwise, who are embracing this idea of annihilationism. I just think they're wrong. Mm-hmm. But you didn't come here to listen to me say things I don't believe.
Can you explain a little bit more about how Christianity shaped your worldview?
Yeah. in the Christian worldview, how to articulate it in just a moment or two. I think that that storyline is huge. I think that the book of Genesis in particular is very important. There's an ordered creation. There's a distinction between the creator and his creation. That men and women are created in the image of God and have an essential dignity that transcends even the very things that we do. That we were created by a triune God who is in relationship within himself, which creates in us. He invested that into us. We need relationship because God himself exists in perfect relationship. God is a communicating job. It's a communicating God in English. He's a communicating God, and therefore we communicate that these vice regents, humanity, this glorious thing that God created, the high point of his creation, was granted stewardship over the earth. So I take it that as I look out and I see everything around us, I understand that we'll have to give an account for how we took care of all God's stuff that he told us to take care of. I understand that we have rebelled against God, that there was a penalty for that, and that because of that, this world is under a curse. It's our fault. We have broken it. I understand we have been striving to make it right ever since. But we have an absolute inability to do that. And so I see the strugglings. First off, I see pain and misery and struggling in the world. And I understand why it's there. Because we are fundamentally broken people living in a world full of broken people. Surrounded by even more broken people. And that's why there's evil in the world, but that it is redeemable. I think that's what gives us hope. I think that's why some people, and I think that's why most people hope for the better, is because there's that vestige of this story that I was talking about, that God will make it right. He made a promise at the very, just about the very instance of that, what we call the fall of man. And then I understand that we're full of strivings and desires to make ourselves right. I understand why there's other religions in the world. I guess things of that nature. I think Genesis is a very, very important book of the Bible for establishing that Christian worldview. There's probably a whole lot more that I could say, but that's probably a good start for it.
One of the things that I've noticed when I try and talk about things like this with other people is very quickly I come to realize that there are certain foundational principles or like worldview that I don't share in common with them. And so you can only go so far before the argument breaks down and there's like you're both just saying the same thing over and over and it doesn't actually mean anything because you aren't arguing from the same foundation. So what do you say to a situation like that where it feels like you don't even live in the same universe as someone when you're trying to talk about something like this because all the foundational principles are different?
Yeah, well, that's another hard question to answer in just a few seconds. I feel you.